not even sure what to say at this point, really. Y'all missed a photo opportunity. A thorn among the roses. Well, it's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. And I'm glad you're here tonight. We're looking forward to what the Lord has for us. I'll mention again, but please pray for Miss Pam. She is sick. She's so sick. And I am not hosting a ladies' retreat. I ain't doing it. I ain't going to do it. And so, but I do have an assistant. Perfect. Anyway, please pray for her. We're going to do some more praying here after a while. Let's pray and ask God to bless the service. Let's do that. Father, thank you for your goodness and grace. Lord, I do lift up my wife to you and pray that you'd touch her and help her, bless her and keep her. Heal her up, Lord. I know that she does not feel well, and that's hard on her, which makes it hard on me, and it's just hard. So I pray that you give her, show her great grace and healing, we pray. Thank you for the folks that are out for this Wednesday night service. I know it's a little bit unusual, Lord, with everything that's going on to prepare for this weekend, but we're not even sure we'll see tomorrow. And so we're excited about being here tonight and what you have for us tonight. And we pray your blessing upon this service, Lord. Help us to sing like it may be the last time that we get to sing to you. You're worthy of our praise. And Father, I pray as we open up the Word of God here in just a little bit, that you'd bless it and use it and help us to draw closer to you because of it. Thank you once again that you love us like you do. Bless now all that's said and done, we pray. And we ask all of these things in Jesus Christ's mighty name. Stand with us if you would. Hymn number 224.
Thank you. The Lord, aren't you glad you're saved?
Amen.
How many got to pass out some tracts this week to people that are probably not going to heaven? Amen. Praise the Lord. They'll never know unless we tell them. Amen. Praise God. Tonight's soul winning tip is life is not fair. Life is not fair. Have you ever said that? I've said it, not today, but I've said it. Amen. So this was our lesson Monday night at the Juvenile Detention Center right down the street here about how life is not fair. And you know, if there's anybody that could say that, probably most of them young men in that detention center. A lot of times when we have prayer before we start, and they fill out prayer requests, and a lot of them say this: God, will you keep our family together? Will you keep my mom clean so we can live together as a family? Because the dads aren't there, and they've got their mom, but they want their mom to stay clean, off of drugs, not going to jail, so the rest of the kids won't get farmed out to... Amen? Man, that just breaks your heart. So life is not fair. We talked about Jim Beadle, his testimony after he got cancer. Many of you know him. And he was less with that cancer. He was unable to talk the rest of his days. And he had a great testimony at the prison. But you know, Brother Beadle, he never expressed to me that life is not fair. You just never got that out of Brother Beadle, amen? Ecclesiastes 7:15, listen to this. All things have I seen in the days of my vanity. There is a just man that perished in his righteousness. There is a wicked man that prolongeth his life in his wickedness. So life is not fair. The good man seems to perish while the wicked man seems to prosper. You know, some people stay bitter all of their lives, missing the life God has for them because of something bad or disappointing that has happened to them. You can almost hear him say, "It's just not fair, God. It's just not fair." Ever been there? In March of 1820, Frances Jane Crosby was born. At the age of 6 weeks, she caught a slight cold in her eyes. She was treated by another doctor because her doctor was out of town. The treatment she received left her blind. It was later learned that the man that treated her was not qualified to practice medicine at all. As this young Fanny Crosby grew up and became old enough to know why she was blind, she never felt any resentment against the man that was responsible, listen to this, but believed it was permitted by the Lord to fulfill his plans in her life. Fanny Crosby's mother had to work to support both of them. Her father died when she was young, so her grandmother spent many, many hours describing the things of nature and heaven to her. She also introduced Fanny to the Bible. Fanny began to devour the Bible. By age 15, she had memorized the first five books of the Bible, with Ruth, Psalms, Proverbs, Song of Solomon, along with a great portion of the New Testament. In the autumn of 1843, the 23-year-old Fanny was the first woman ever to address a joint session of the United States Congress. She simply paid tribute to the Congress for helping blind people. Then she began to pay tribute to the Lord and how good he had been to her. The notable assembly included President Quincy Adams. All had tears dripping off their faces by the end of her testimony. Fanny Crosby wrote over 8,000 hymns and poems, including praise him, safe in the arms of Jesus, near the cross, pass me not, O gentle Savior, rescue the perishing, blessed assurance, all the way my Savior leads me, draw me near, to God be the glory. Though your sins be as scarlet, tell me the story of Jesus, redeemed how I love to proclaim it. Jesus is calling, he hideth my soul, many, many more. At the age of 8 years old, Fanny wrote her first recorded poem. Listen to this. Oh, what a happy soul am I, although I cannot see. I am resolved that in this world, contented I will be. How many blessings I enjoy that other people don't. To weep and sigh because I'm blind, I cannot and I won't. God is in his infinite wisdom knew he could trust Fanny Crosby with blindness. And in that blindness, her life would give glory to God. I'll leave you with this question. How about you, Christian? Is your testimony and witness for Jesus Christ cooled off because life is not fair?
Thank you, Brother Mike. Appreciate that very much. If we're saved by the grace of God, we've got everything we need. Oh, it's just a fact. It truly is a fact. You know, it could, in a 24-hour period or even shorter, we could lose everything we have. It's really true. And we ought to learn to be satisfied with Jesus as much as we possibly can, for sure. Anybody not get a prayer page that need one? If you need one, please put your hand up down here. Brother Mike, down front. Oh, I'm sorry, Brother D. Anybody else? You guys did a good job tonight. We certainly need to continue to pray for our country and for the leaders of our country and the needs there. We need for God to intervene in all of this. We do, yeah, and I know you know that. But don't forget to pray for America. Under special request, I'm going to highlight a few things. We'll get right to prayer. The first bold under special request, Kelly Elder is going to have rotator cuff surgery tomorrow. It's an outpatient surgery, but it's going to take a while for that to heal up after it's done. Please pray everything goes well for her tonight. Pray for her. Pray for the doctors, everything there. Pray for quick healing. I know she'd appreciate that very, very much. Just a couple underneath her, Pastor David Hetzer and his church family. There was a very untimely death in his church. I'm not going to go into details, but they need prayer. He does for wisdom on how to handle things, and then the church does just for, they're going to be hurting. So please pray for Brother Hetzer and his church family. Right underneath him, Miss Tanya Lee. Going to court on April 30th regarding the adoption of her grandchildren. And I know she'd appreciate our prayers at this time. About four underneath that, Miss Olga Patterson. We've been praying a lot for her. They're at a place right now that some decisions have to be made. The doctors need to make some decisions. Family needs to make some decisions. And it's just a real up-in-the-air time. And we really need to lift her and the family up to the Lord tonight. If you would do that, please do that. About four names under her, Brother Marty We haven't said a lot about Brother Marty and the health problems that he has, but he's got some very serious health problems, and he needs a doctor to acknowledge that and say, we've got to get something done, truly. He has an aneurysm on his aorta, and that's just a serious situation. And the doctors just seem to be stumbling around and don't want to make a decision about it. He really needs some surgery. So please pray for him tonight. Also, I know that he and Miss Lisa appreciate that very, very much. And then Miss Pam, if you'd pray that she'd be healed up by this Friday, that would be great. Brother Ron Jackson's fixing to head back to Ukraine in the next few days. I know he'd appreciate our prayers. And then the ladies' retreat, of course, for Mrs. Corley, that she will bring the lessons that the ladies need for everything just to go smooth. For those that are traveling in, we've got, I don't know, over 300 that are going to be traveling in. I think 380 is a total at this point anyway. But many of them be traveling in, traveling back home. Let's pray for their travels. Let's pray that God will work in hearts and lives. Let's pray that if there's someone that comes that is lost, that God would touch their heart about that. It'd be great if someone got saved during the ladies' retreat this year, truly. And so let's make that a real matter of prayer tonight. So let's take some time to pray, whether you want to pray with family or friends or however you might want to do that, and then we'll continue on with the service tonight. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we're so very thankful for the prayers that have gone up and are still going up. Lord, for these different things we mentioned tonight and other requests that have been made that you have put on people's hearts, I'm sure. And we're just very thankful that you're a prayer answering God and you hear these things, and we want your perfect will done in each and every one of them. And Lord, I just ask that you would bless and help, give grace and strength and guidance, healing, Lord, as only you can, that you might do things in these different situations, Lord, that would bring honor and glory to you and would show and prove once again that you are Almighty God and you can do what no one else can do. Lord, again, for the service tonight, bless and help us. Help it not just to be another service, but to be a service where you speak to hearts, Lord, and you draw us closer to you. Do what we can't do, please, and we'll certainly bless you and give you honor and glory for it all. For we ask all of these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Stand with us again.
go ahead and have a word of prayer and ask the Lord to bless the offering tonight. Father, we do come to you tonight. Lord, there's so many things to be thankful for, that your goodness and your graciousness to us. And I just pray that you would help us, Lord, to give cheerfully and just out of the abundance that you've given us. And just pray that you'd take what is given tonight and that you would bless it and use it, Lord, that it would bring glory and honor to you. And just, again, we just thank you for your goodness to us and ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would be seated, please.
For that. We're going to go to Joshua chapter 14 tonight. In your Bible, if you will, the book of Joshua and chapter number 14. Joshua chapter 14. Joshua 14. Look down to verse number 6. We'll begin our reading in verse number 6. The Bible says, "Then the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal. And Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said unto him," I'm going to start that over. "Then the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal. And Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said unto him," unto Joshua, "Thou knowest the thing that the Lord said unto Moses, the man of God, concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea. 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to espy out the land. And I brought him word again as it was in mine heart. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord my God. Moses sware on that day, saying, Surely the land whereon thy feet have trodden shall be thine inheritance and thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord my God. And now, behold, the Lord hath kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now, lo, I am this day 85 years old, 85 years old. As yet I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so is my strength now, for war, both to go out and to come in. Now therefore, give me this mountain whereof the Lord spake in that day. For thou heardest in that day how the Anakims were there, and that the cities were great and fenced. If so be the Lord will be with me, then I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said." And Joshua blessed him, and gave unto Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, Hebron for an inheritance. Hebron, therefore, became the inheritance of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, unto this day, because that he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. And the name of Hebron before was Kirjath Arba, which Arba was a great man among the Anakims, and the land had rest from war. I titled the message tonight, Caleb, the Man and His Mountain. Let's pray and we'll get right on with it. Father, one last time we ask again for your goodness over this message, your power to preach it, the liberty. I need a little help tonight with my eyesight, Lord, and certainly my brain. Just help me to stay on track, say all the things you want me to say, and to refrain from anything you would not have me to say. We just want to be a messenger. I pray your will be done tonight in the lives of the people that are here and even those that are watching by live stream. And we'll thank you and praise you for it, for we ask all of these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Thank you so much for standing. Please do be seated. We know that Caleb was a part of Israel when they came out of Israel 45 years earlier. He and Joshua were the only living Israelites left over from the Exodus. He was one of the spies that was sent by Moses to spy out the land. He was there when God divided the waters of the Red Sea. Israel crossing the Red Sea is a picture of salvation, free from bondage, free from Pharaoh. Observing Israel as they journey through the wilderness shows us there is much more to salvation than just being set free. I was saved. I know I've already said it a lot of times, but I was saved 40 years ago this month. And I'm thankful that God forgave all my sin and that he freed me from the bondage of sin. I'm thankful for that. But there's been a lot of growing that has had to go on in these 40 years, and it continues. God had a land flowing with milk and honey prepared for them. It would be a land of giants, It would be a land of battles, but it was theirs if they wanted it. And as you know, Israel chose to wander in the wilderness. So here's another great picture of the Christian life. God saves us and promises us that we can have a life of victory and in really an intense spiritual joy, but rather than claim what is rightfully ours, things like peace and joy and fellowship and power and the glory of God, we often choose to live in a spiritual wilderness, defeated, depressed. It seems like a lot of Christians today are guilty of spiritual window shopping, if you will. They like a lot of things that they see in other Christians' lives, but they never take the step to acquire it for themselves. One day, Brett and Amy were talking, and he asked her, said, why do you call it shopping when you never buy anything? And she replied, well, why do you call it hunting when you never chewed anything? As Christians, we need to do more than window shop, because we have God's promises. And so we need to incorporate them. And tonight I want us to see what it was that enabled this 85-year-old man to enjoy that which God had promised him all those years before. Caleb pictures a Christian who is willing to pay the price, fight the battles, and win the victory that God has waiting for him. It is possible for all of us. I'll say it again, if you're saved by the grace of God, it's possible for all of us. God wants to do that for us, absolutely so. And in these verses, we're shown how to claim our little part of Canaan, if you will, and walk in victory day by day. But we have to notice Caleb's strength here. Look at verse 8 again, if you will. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord my God. Verse number 9, and Moses sware on that day, saying, surely the land wherein thy feet have trodden shall be thine inheritance and thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord my God. Look at verse number 14. Hebron therefore became the inheritance of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh of Kenizzite, unto this day, because he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. And I know that you notice that he was totally submitted to God. Wholly followed the Lord. This is said about Caleb 5 times in the Old Testament. And it refers to the fact that Caleb was committed to keeping the distance between the Lord and himself to a minimum. He wanted to stay close to God. I mean, he wholly followed the Lord. Every inch, every ounce, every nerve, every fiber of Caleb belonged to God. Now, you may think that because you are not a preacher or a deacon or a Sunday school teacher or whatever the case may be, that God does not expect total surrender on your part, but that's wrong, wrong, wrong. If you're a born-again child of God, God expects total surrender. God deserves your all. If you're holding back even a little bit, it's too much. Well, why is that, preacher? Because if you're saved, you belong to him. You were bought with a price. You already belong to him. Uncommitted Christians never gain victory over sin and complacency. I'm going to say it again. Uncommitted Christians never gain victory over sin and complacency. No, if we're not totally committed, we can get very complacent very quick. We can think we've done enough or doing enough, whatever the case may be. We've got to be careful about that. And the more committed we are, the more God's going to work on us. Somebody say amen right there. No, it's absolutely the truth. The more committed we are to him, the more he is going to work on us, because the more we yield to him, I mean, asking God, help me, Lord, correct me, God, change me, mold me, make me, whatever you need to do in my life, I am willing to allow you to do that. And I'm telling you, when we give him that when we yield to him in that manner, I'm telling you, he'll work on us. Now, some people say, I don't know why God's not working in my life. It's because you're not committed to him. You're holding back somewhere. Somewhere along the way, he has asked you to do this or do that or quit this and quit that. And you think, well, that's just too much or that's not enough or whatever the case may be. And because of that, you have grown stagnant. At one time, you were on fire for God, wanting to do whatever God would have you to do. Yes, let's go into the promised land. Yes, let's fight the giants. Let's just take the victory. But it's not like that anymore. Because somewhere along the way, you decided that you were going to run your life and instead of letting God run your life. The story is told of a man that was being towed. His car was being towed to be repaired, and he was riding in the car as it was being towed. And when he arrived at the repair shop, the tow truck driver told him, said, "You know, I didn't think I was going to make it up that last big hill." And the man replied, "Well, I didn't either, and that's why I kept the brakes on so we wouldn't roll backwards." Yeah. To live without total dedication to Christ is the same. It's the same thing as trying to go forward and keeping the brakes on. It's not going to work. I'm telling you, you're not getting the best that God has for you. There's only one way to stand up against the devil, and that is to be totally committed to God. You have to be committed to Him. Come on, James 1:8, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. We can't think that we're going to live for God and live for ourselves at the same time. It doesn't work. It's just not going to work. Jesus demands total commitment. Total commitment. That we just give Him our all. Well, one day a chicken and a pig were walking down the street together, and the pig noticed a billboard that had a picture of a plate of ham and eggs. And the pig, seeing the sign, said to the chicken, "You know, for you, that's just an ordinary day's work, but for me, that's total commitment." That's what God wants. He wants total commitment. He wants your everything. He wants your all. You know, D.L. Moody, a great preacher of the past, was saved at the age of 19. And he heard an evangelist by the name of Henry Varley say, "The world has yet to see what God can do in and through and with and for a man wholly committed to Him." And D.L. Moody said, "By God's grace, I will be that man." Now, I don't know how much you've read about Moody. I've got several books of his and books about his life. We have to understand this. Moody was an uncultured, uneducated, untrained shoe salesman, but God used him to move two continents for Christ. Well, preacher, why did he do that? Because he's committed. So we have to ask ourselves, truly, are we totally sold out to Jesus Christ? Your commitment to Christ affects all of your other relationships. Come on, you can write that one down. It'd be a good thing to write down in the leaf of your Bible. Your commitment to Christ will affect all your other relationships. The more devoted you are to Jesus, the more faithful you're going to be to your church and to your family and to your friends. And the Lord demands total commitment from every one of us. Anything less will keep you from reaching your Canaan land, your victorious Christian life. In Luke chapter 9, verse 62, the Bible says, "And Jesus said unto him, No man having his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God." Well, once we start on our Christian life, we need to keep going forward. No place to back up, no place to stop, no place to quit. God just wants us to keep moving forward. And all this comes down to one truth. If you, like Caleb, will close the gap between yourself and God, if you pursue Him with every fiber of your being, He will do the same toward you. Come on, God hadn't changed. He's still the same. James chapter 4, verse 8 says, "Draw nigh to God, and He'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded." God just wants us to draw close to Him. He wants us to keep that gap closed. And always in all of this, we can see Caleb's triumph, verse number 12. "Now therefore, give me this mountain wherefore the Lord spake in that day. For thou heardest in that day how the Anakims were, and that the cities were great and fenced. If so be the Lord will be with me, then I shall be able to drive them out as the Lord said." Now the other spies had said that they couldn't take the land. They said, "The Anakim's just too strong. We can't do this, not at all." But Caleb had faith in God's word. His success was in the faith of God's word. Well, where did he get that? Let's back up. Verse number 10. "And now behold, the Lord had kept me alive, and as he said, these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now I am this day 85 years old. As yet I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so is my strength now, for war both go out and to come in." He was not going to be defeated. He was not going to be defeated by either the presence or the fear of the Anakims. He was going to go forward. He was going to take God at his word. Come on, we know this. Caleb had seen the promised land, and for 45 years that vision was burned into his heart as he wandered through the wilderness. And while others were complaining, Caleb looked for a mountain where milk and honey flowed and where the grapes of Eshcol grow. He was able to see beyond the circumstances into the promises of the Lord. I'm here to tell you tonight, as your pastor, we need some people who have been cut from the same cloth. No, he had envisioned that land for 45 years, trusting God. That land had been promised to them, and he wanted it all. And if they could have the valleys and the orchards, he could claim that majestic mountain also. I want that mountain. See, faith is trusting God to do what he says he will do. Okay. We can even take. I started to say small promises, but it's really not. We can even take promises like, "I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me." People say, "Well, preacher, I just can't give this up or give that up." You can through Christ. People say, "Well, I just can't seem to find the victory in this area or that area." You can through Christ. The trouble is, now listen to me, the trouble is that there's distance between you and Christ. You're not close to him the way you should be. Because I'm telling you, he is all powerful. And he can, and he can help us through whatever we might be facing. Faith is trusting God to do what he says he should do, would do. Faith does not have an alternative. Now I'm just letting that soak in for a minute. Faith does not have an alternative. Tell him I'll call him back. What do you mean by that, preacher? Faith does not have an alternative. The Bible says in Romans chapter 14, verse 23, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So we live by faith, right? Not by sight. Come on, we're trusting God. We move because God says to move. We go because God says to go. We live the way that God says because that's the way he says. I'm telling you, faith is trusting God and not self. We have to quit. "Well, preacher, I just can't do that." We can do all things through Christ. Come on, that's a promise from God. Are you saved by the grace of God tonight? I'm telling you, the same Holy Ghost that lives in you lives in me and everybody else in here that's saved. And he is all powerful, and he can guide us, and he can direct us, and he can give us victory. And whatever we might be facing, we just have to trust him more than we're trusting ourselves. Faith is simply taking God at his word and doing as it says. We just have to have that kind of faith. You've probably heard this story before. I think I've used it before. The captain of an ocean steamer told the story of his ship being engulfed by a dense fog off the case of Newfoundland. And it was Wednesday evening, and the captain had been on the bridge for 24 hours trying to make his way through this dense fog when somebody tapped him on the shoulder. He turned and saw one of his passengers. The passenger was George Mueller. "Captain," said Mr. Mueller, "I must be in Quebec by Saturday afternoon." The captain responded with, "That's impossible. There's no way I can go any quicker because of this dense fog." So Miss Mueller said, "Well, let's go down into the chart room and pray." And the captain, it is said, thought he had a lunatic on board. What he said. "Do you know how dense this fog is?" he asked. Mr. Mueller said, "No. My eye is not on the density of the fog, but on the living God who controls every circumstance of my life." Once in the chart room, Mueller got down on his knees and prayed. He prayed this prayer, "O Lord, if it is consistent with thy will, please remove this fog in 5 minutes. Thou knowest the engagement thou didst make for me in Quebec for Saturday. I believe it is thy will." And after Mr. Mueller prayed, the captain started to pray, but Mr. Mueller stopped him and said, "There's no need for you to pray. God's already answered. The fog is gone. And it was. In the day and time that we live in, we don't seem to have enough faith to even ask for such a thing. And the only reason behind that is we are not trusting God like we should. Some of you read about George Mueller, very same George Mueller who believed God for his provisions. He had orphanages, and he raised millions of dollars in the 18th century for those orphanages, and never asked for a dime. He'd pray, people would give. He'd pray for food, people would deliver. He prayed for what the needs were, and I'm telling you, God blessed him over and over and over again. He just took the needs to God. He asked God in faith, and he received that which he needed. Faith. Faith is more than saying, please get this, faith is more than saying that you believe. Faith is acting upon what you believe. You have to act upon it. You have to trust God with that. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 1, the Bible says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Without faith, nothing can be accomplished spiritually the way that God would have it to be. And faith is never a blind leap, but a deep, settled conviction that God's going to do as he promised. He's going to do as he promised. So Caleb had a battle because he had to face the giants. Over in the book of Numbers, chapter 13, verse 33, the Bible says, and there we saw giants, the son of Anak, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sight. So for Caleb to claim what God had promised, this is big. For him to claim what God had promised, he had to go against the majority. Caleb, you're an idiot. Come on, can't you hear people saying? Caleb, he is so foolish. Can you believe that? He thinks that he can just go over there and conquer that land, conquer them giants, goodness gracious. I'm here to tell you tonight, there's always going to be somebody that's going to say it can't be done. Somebody's saying like, well, you know, it's never been done like that before. We just can't afford it. It just can't be done. It can't be done. It can't be done. I'm telling you, with God, all things are possible. Surely we can trust him. And sometime as you follow God, there will be times when you follow God that you're going to have to stand alone. But that's okay, because if you're standing on the word of God and the will of God, then you have never been in better company. God's there for you. And he had to deal with the giants. Talks about that in verses 8 and 9. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord my God. And Moses swore in that day, saying, surely the land where my feet have trodden shall be thine inheritance and thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord thy God. Over in Numbers, chapter 14, and verse 8, it says, if the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. Only, listen, only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Fear them not. You know, God will fight our battles. What are you talking about, preacher? I'm saying that all of us face giants in our life. All of us. Excuse me. Like what? Habitual sins. Financial difficulties. Health issues. family breakups, distress, but just a lack of faith, apathy, complacency, just wanting to give up, failures we have had in the past. We fight those, don't we? But I'm telling you, God is there to give us victory over those things if we will wholly follow Him. How we deal with these giants will determine whether or not we make it to the land of victory or not. And God wants to give you that victory. He wants you to have it. I mean, even he had to, Caleb even had to deal with some doubt. Well, what do you mean, preacher? It had been 45 years since God had made that promise. 45 years. Come on, Caleb was human. I'd have to think somewhere along the way in those 45 years, he probably had thoughts, is this promise still good? Has this promise ceased? There may have been times that during those 45 years that Caleb questioned whether it would ever come to pass or not. 45 years. So what does that tell us? It tells us this. When God makes a promise, He'll give us the strength to see the fulfillment. Never count God or yourself out. Well, I just don't see how God could do this. That's a good reason to lean on Him. That's a good reason to trust Him. That's a good reason to keep going for Him. Just keep going. Yeah, by faith. By faith we step out. By faith we keep going. By faith we keep doing what God would have us to do. True faith looks beyond the present circumstances and sees the provision of the Almighty. He is there for us, ladies and gentlemen. Absolutely so. Some of you old folks in here remember comedian Jerry Clower. He was a hoot. He told a story about his uncle, Versie Leadbetter. He told a lot of stories about Versie Leadbetter, but he told this story about Versie Leadbetter, who had a mule named Della. And one day, Della fell into this cistern. Uncle Versie was supposed to have covered it up, but he didn't. And so now Uncle Versie has this problem. He's got this mule down at the bottom of the cistern, the best mule that he had, and no way to get her out of there. And so he didn't want her to stay down there and just starve to death, so he decided he'd get a shovel and cover her up. And no, and it's going to be cruel, but it wouldn't be as cruel and as inhumane as to let Della starve to death at the bottom of this very deep cistern. So Uncle Versie Leadbetter took a shovel full of dirt and threw it down the cistern, and every time the shovel full of dirt hit Della's back, she'd shake it off and stomp on it. And it wasn't long before Della had shaken off enough of the dirt that she was high enough to jump out of the cistern. We're like that mule. Either our problems will bury us, or we can keep shaking them off until we rise above them. God wants us to keep going for Him. So, we see in this Caleb's completion. Caleb got his mountain that God had promised. And it had been promised 45 years earlier to this. How many of you would keep chasing the same dream for 45 years? That's a good question to ask ourselves. Especially if we feel like it's something that God would have for us. And this turned out to be great, that he had the faith to continue to do that, because the mountain was the burial place for Sarah and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. This was Israel's heritage. This was their land. It was their land. It didn't belong to Anakims. It belonged to them because God gave it to them. A lot of Baptists have all but lost their heritage. There's too many weak Baptists today. The name Baptist really doesn't mean to most people as what it did to most people in the, as it did in the first church of Jerusalem. And we know this. We know that since that time there have been over 50 million Baptists slaughtered for the faith and doctrine that we so loosely hang on today. People are so willing just to toss it away. It meant something to them. They're willing to die for it. And they did so that you and I might have that truth. There's some Baptist churches that are taking the name Baptist off their signs. And I say, if they can do it, go ahead and do so. I like to think I'm ready to die for it. We have a great heritage. I like to think, if need be, I will give my life for the faith and doctrine that was passed down to me. Preacher, you really think it's that important? Even more so, probably. Because if over 50 million others have died for it, why wouldn't we be willing to? That ought to be our battle cry tonight. We ought to refuse to give up, back up, shut up, or be held up until we've stood up, lined up, read up, prayed up, confessed up, stored up, spoke up, looked up, and filled up on everything the Lord wants to give His children. Fight the good fight. Keep the faith. We ought to settle for nothing less than that place of perfect fellowship with our Lord God. Let me ask you a question. Where are you in your personal walk with God tonight? Your personal walk with God. Have you entered into that promised land, that victorious Christian living, or are you just wandering around the wilderness still struggling day after day after day after day? I'm here to tell you tonight that God has a place of peace and power for you, but you have to be willing to claim your possession. And I'll go ahead and say it, it's not for the faint-hearted. But it is for the faith-hearted. Amen. By faith, we enter into that. And maybe you need to come and claim that Canaan, that victorious life tonight. Because see, there's a vast difference between a promise and a possession. We have the promise. We just have to be willing by faith to take possession. God promised Israel the land, and they had to possess it before it came theirs. And we know this, God has victory for His children. That's His promise. But that promise has to be actively pursued and possessed before it becomes a reality. And we just have to follow God's steps. We have to be willing by faith to follow God's steps. There may be someone in here tonight that's not even saved by God's grace. Why not make the decision to come to the Lord Jesus and receive Him as your personal Savior? Well, preacher, I got a lot of time to do that. You don't know that. If we are ever to have all that the Lord wants us to have, it is definitely going to take a step of faith on our part. Maybe it's time that we increased our faith by taking some steps of faith to just do what we know that God would have us to do. There's people sitting in here that have made decisions before in your life to wholly follow God, but you're not doing it anymore. And you're wondering why it's so hard to be a Christian. And you're doing things you know God wouldn't have you do. Why not take a step of faith tonight down to an old-fashioned altar and renew some things with God? And let him give you victory in some areas that you know you need victory in. It could be the start of something very good in your life. Stand with me, would you? Let's all stand. Heavenly Father, thank you for the challenges you give us. Thank you for stories such as the story of Joshua, Caleb, his willingness just to wholly follow you, no matter what anybody else did. And I don't know how you may have challenged hearts tonight. My prayer is that your perfect will would be done. That folks would be honest with themselves and honest with you if they're not where they need to be with you. They'd be honest. And they'd seek you, taking the steps of faith they need to take to be close to you. Father, whatever needs to happen these next few minutes ahead, we pray that your will would be done. We'll thank you for what you accomplished, for we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Many have come to the altar. You need to come tonight. Why don't you? I know you do. God's dealt with your heart about whatever he dealt with your heart about. Why not let him have his way? You're not regretted if you do. Take a step of faith. Preacher, I just don't know. I don't know if I do it. I just don't know. I don't know that I can continue to do it. Can with God's help.
Thou hast
God's people said. Amen. Amen. Very thankful for the amazing grace and faith of God. Amen. Very thankful for that. Continue to pray for the upcoming ladies' retreat. Pray for one another. We all need prayer. Pray for your brothers and sisters in Christ. Pray for Riverside Baptist Church. Don't forget the folks we highlighted, certainly Miss Kelly, and having her rotator cuff surgery tomorrow, and then the just very important things on there. I hope you'll pray daily for these things. The ladies' retreat is live stream cut. Thank you.